اللهم إني أعوذ بك من علم لا ينفع وقلب لا يخشع ونفس لا تشبع ودعاء لا يسمع. ربنا لا تزغ قلوبنا بعد إذ هديتنا وهب لنا من لدنك رحمة إنك أنت الوهاب. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي آمين. الحمد لله رب العالمين. الله بروت أس باك فنشت رمضان دن. سبحان الله. الحمد لله رب العالمين. May الله سبحانه وتعالى make us follow the footsteps of the Sahaba, that we keep asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept from us. Don't forget this. 6 months after Ramadan, they used to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept from them. So the easiest dua probably you will say is dua Sayyidina Ibrahim when he was building the Kaaba. رَبَّنَا تَقَبَّلْ مِنَّا إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ السَّمِيعُ الْعَلِيمُ وَتُبْ عَلَيْنَا إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ التَّوَّابُ الرَّحِيمُ. Ya Allah, accept from us. تَقَبَّلْ مِنَّا. Accept from us. إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ السَّمِيعُ الْعَلِيمُ. You all knowing, you all hearing. وَتُوبْ عَلَيْنَا, and accept our repentance, or forgive, another meaning, forgive our sins, إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ الْغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ. So keep saying this, don't forget this for yourself, before, and I always say this, before you pray for your children, or for the marriage, or for the college, or for all this, don't forget to pray for yourself, because there will be a day, Allah knows, who there will be no one to pray for us. I mean, I can't guarantee anybody will remember me after 50 years from now, let alone maybe after 10 or 20. So don't forget to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept from us, Ya Rabbi, Ameen. And subhanAllah, I don't know, for some reason Allah wanted me to speak on this topic. And inshallah, I'm not going to talk about the fiqh, a lot of the fiqh. Maybe one, it's about 4 or 5 series. Let's see how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make it happen. But mainly, I need to bring back to myself before anyone else, what is this all salah about? Is because for a lot of us, and a lot of the Muslims actually, there's two kinds. Either we do not glorify the salah, period, done, right? And unfortunately, not only some people don't pray, but some of those who don't pray, and even some of those who pray and see people don't pray, it's okay. It's becoming okay. That's the main thing. It's, you know what? Oh, they don't pray. Versus in Ramadan, if you see someone don't fast, oh, right? So what happened? The priorities changed. And who changed them? We? Absolutely. Allah didn't say the salah, the siyam of Ramadan is more important. One of the things we're going to talk about. So the main thing that we need to bring at least to us, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will guide everyone. And before I forget, because I want to say this, don't judge anyone, right? You never know. You never know. When you see someone who doesn't pray, don't say anything. Do one thing. And that is, make dua for them. Yes, ask Allah to guide them. The same way He guided you and me, He can easily guide them, right? Whatever they say, whatever things that really hurt you and upset you, I'm not saying it's okay, but don't look down at them. Because when I look down at them, then I am actually sinning at this point, because I think I am better than them. So the main thing of this is going to be bringing back to us the what is this salah all about. Right? It's not like what we do. Most of us, alhamdulillah, we know what to do. But what is it? Why it is that important, or should be that important? And start by the simple thing. What does the word salah mean? And unfortunately, it's translated to English as a prayer. And the prayer, it's part of it is for sure is a prayer. But it is not a prayer only. So what is salah? When you look at the root of the word, what is salah mean? I'm sorry? Glorify. One of them is glorify, absolutely, at-tamjeed. You glorify. You glorify. So I need you to remember these meanings, because this is what's going to, one of the sessions will be about the khushu', our main problem. But inshallah, but at least the more I remind myself of these basic, simple, hopefully, bi-idhnillah, by His grace, it's going to come back to me. So one of the meanings is absolutely to glorify, at-tamjeed, and you're glorifying Allah. One of the meaning is connections. It's a connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The main meaning of it is actually is a dua. As-salah fi al-lugha, salah in the Arabic language is prayer, is asking. asking Allah for something. And there's a hadith of Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam, the meaning of, and that's where the scholars came and says, this is the meaning. He says, if any one of you is fasting and he got invited for food, he started like this. If any one of you got invited for food, let them eat. If he or she was fasting, فَلْيُصَلِّ. Meaning, let them make a dua for that person. So the scholar says, one of the meaning is dua, is prayer, is I'm asking Allah. And again, one of the sessions will be about what are we saying inside salah. Of course, we're going to say Allahu Akbar, what I am saying. So number one is a dua. I am literally, think of it this way. And this is a very good way to bring the awe inside you, is that you are in audience with Allah. Allah gave you the time you give him. He didn't say salah is 5 minutes. Subhanallah. He didn't put a time for how long you pray. He put a time when you pray. So he will say, at this time, you come. How long you want to stay, it's up to you. You want to stay 2 minutes? You want to stay 5? You want to stay 30 minutes? You want to stay an hour? It's up to you. So this is how I think, number one. I am being invited by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to stand in front of him. So it is a connection. It's a dua. It's a supplication. And it's glorifying. And there's one more meaning. We all say the ayah on the Jumu'ah. What do we say? In Allah وملائكته يصلون على النبي يصلون على النبي. What does that mean? Allah and His Messenger send salah upon Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam. What does this salah mean? Istighfar. So one of the meanings of salah is istighfar, asking Allah for forgiveness. And if you think of it now with all of these, think of the salah. It's a dua. I am asking Allah, supplication. It's a connection. I'm glorifying Allah. I'm asking Allah to forgive me. And I am in audience with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that's the first thing. Keep reminding yourself, even if you know. Subhanallah, Allah knows how much personally my salah changed since I start reading this again. Because ذكر فإن الذكرى تنفع المؤمنين. Remind people, and those benefit from reminders are the believers. So the first thing is the meaning. Number two, and I'm just going to go by one by one. How many times the salah, the word salah is in the Quran? More than 60. One of them will be probably inshallah next week, will cover salah in the Quran. What meaning it came? Number three, which is, I really love this one, and this is how the scholars looked at it, and says, the only act of worship that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not give an excuse not to do it. The only one, whether you're a traveler, whether you are not a traveler, whether you are sick, whether you are healthy, whether you are in a state of fear, whether you are feeling fine, anywhere, there is no excuse for salah except one, where the salah becomes not obligation anymore, when you are not in your right state of mind. Look at the others, like the five pillars of Islam. Look at the four, which are the actions. Zakah, you have to have two conditions, right? The minimum amount and the time. If you don't have the amount, you don't do it. If the time didn't come, you don't do it, right? Hajj. Right? You all know, لِمَنِ اسْتَطَعَ عَلَيْهِ سَبِيلًا, you have to have the ability to do it. And then, صوم, same thing. If you're a traveler, we just finished. If you're a traveler, it's okay if you don't want to pray, if you don't want to fast. The only no excuse is as-salah. And look at it, absolutely. If you are sick, if you're tired, if you are, it is, there is ways of doing them. The way changes, but the action itself, it's never changed. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said this, إِنَّ الصَّلَاةَ كَانَتْ عَلَى الْمُؤْمِنِينَ كِتَابًا مَوْقُوتًا. Verily, says in Surah An-Nisa, verily, salah is upon the believers, كِتَابًا مَوْقُوتًا, an obligation in certain times. So I have to say myself, looking at Salah, I have no choice. I have no options. And I, especially for the young, alhamdulillah, I see a lot of good young people with us. When I have an exam tomorrow, do I have a choice not to study? For sure I'm studying. The only difference is how much I'm studying. But there's no way tomorrow is my exam and I'm not studying. I have no choice. So the same thing, look at Salah, is a non-choice, non-choice at all, subhanAllah. The second thing is, and this is the only ibadah that specified Salah, you can do it alone. You can do it with a group. You can do it as the five obligation. You can do it extras. Then you can do it for the dead person. You can do it for istikhara, for when you need Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to guide you to make a decision. When there is an eclipse. There is so many ways in life that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brought the salah as part of it. So even the forms changes. Which salah, the only salah that there is no ruku' and sujood in it? In a janazah. Different, right? You come salat al-eid, right? You just prayed it. What is the difference? It's different. In which way? Takbirs, much more takbirs. Subhanallah. Salat the eclipse, very long reading. That's the main. You continue doing the salah. This is the ones that long. You keep doing the salah as long as the eclipse is going on. So the point I'm trying to make, there is almost every action in my life, there is a salah for it. There is a form of salah. So it's part of my life. Part of my life. That's number one. Number two, no religion in this earth, there was no salah mentioned with them. Look at the prophets before us. What was the dua of Sayyidina Ibrahim in Mecca? In Surah Ibrahim. What did he say? Rabbi inni askantu min dhurriyati biwadin ghayri dhi zar'in inda baytika al-muharram. Rabbana, for what? Liyuqimu salah. I'm going to translate. Rabbi, Sayyidina Ibrahim, is talking to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Ibrahim itself. The page before the last, where he starts talking to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. First thing he said, Rabbi, oh my Lord, inni, I, Sayyidina Ibrahim, askantu min dhurriyati, I left from my offspring in baytika al-muharram, inda baytika al-muharram, in this holy land, made them to make this place their home. For what? This was desert. At that point, there was nothing. For what? Liyuqimu salah. Liyuqimu salah. Right? Sayyidina Ismail, his son, go to Surah Maryam. How did Allah describe him? وَذْكُرْ فِي الْكِتَابِ إِسْمَاعِيلِ إِنَّهُ كَانَ صَادِقَ الْوَعْدِ وَكَانَ رَسُولًا نَبِيًّا. Mention to them Ismail. Who's Ismail alayhi salam? The son of Sayyidina Ibrahim. كَانَ صَادِقَ الْوَعْدِ. He was truthful and fulfilled his promise. وَكَانَ رَسُولًا نَبِيًّا. And he was a prophet and a messenger. And then, وَكَانَ يَأْمُرُ أَهْلَهُ بِالصَّلَاةِ وَالزَّكَاةِ وَكَانَ عِنْدَ رَبِّهِ مَرْضِيًّا. And he used to order his family بالصلاه. First thing. والزكاة وكان عند ربه مرضية. And he was عند ربه مرضية. He was absolutely, Allah was pleased with him. Prophets, right? Sayyidina Musa, when Allah talked with him, what did he say? Surah Taha. What did Allah say to him? إنني أنا الله لا إله إلا أنا فَعَبُدْنِي وَأَقِمِ الصَّلَاةَ لِذِكْرِي. Allah is talking to Sayyidina Musa. First thing, introducing himself. إِنَّنِي أَنَ اللَّهُ. I, Allah, the Allah. لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا أَنَا. There is no God but me. فَعَبُدْنِي. Worship me. And how do I worship Allah? It's not my choice, the way I like. Oh, I have Allah in my heart. وَأَقِمِ الصَّلَاةَ لِذِكْرِي. Perform, establish salah so people remember me. Establish salah. So it's not something new with us. It is there. Now go to Surah Maryam. After Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talked about all the prophets, right? Including Sayyidina Ismail. And what did he say afterward? And this is us. فَخَلَفَ مِن بَعْدِهِمْ خَلْفٌ. Generations came after the prophets. And Surah Maryam, Allah mentioned all the prophets, starting with Sayyidina Zakariya, and then Sayyidina Maryam, and then he went Sayyidina Ibrahim, and then Sayyidina Musa, and then Ismail, and Sayyidina Idris. And then he said, فَخَلَفَ مِن بَعْدِهِمْ خَلْفٌ. After all, came generation. What was the description? First thing, huh? أَضَاعُ الصَّلَاةُ. They lost it. Subhanallah. It's in the Quran. أَضَاعُ الصَّلَاةُ. It became not important. Not important. And why? And Allah gives it here. وَاتَّبَعُ الشَّهَوَاتِ. They followed their own desires. فَخَلَفَ مِن بَعْدِهِمْ خَلْفٌ أَضَاعُوا الصَّلَاةَ وَاتَّبَعُوا الشَّهَوَاتِ فَسَوْفَ يَلْقَوْنَ غَيَّا. Then you're going to see severe punishment. So salah, we really have to bring all these principles, basics, at least again, as I started, again, at least to me. Don't think of your children now. Don't think of your friend, right? Yeah, no. Think of yourself first. Because you and I and a lot of the Muslims, salah is in reality, it's a habit. As we some says in Arabic, إِنَّهَا عَدَةٌ وَلَيْسَ عِبَادَةٌ. It's a habit, not an act of worship. And one of the reasons you say this, and I'm talking about myself, I'm not talking about anybody, and you look at yourself too. Because Allah said in Surah Al-Ankabut, He put a principle, what should salah do to you? And what did he say? أُتْلُ مَا أُوحِيَ مِنَ الْكِتَابِ وَأَقِمِ الصَّلَةِ. Recite to them what has been revealed from the book. وَأَقِمِ الصَّلَةِ. And establish salah. Surah Al-Ankabut, spider. Now comes in. إِنَّ الصَّلَاةَ تَنْهَى عَنِ الْفَحْشَاءِ وَالْمُنْكَرِ. Verily salah, the act of the prayer, prevents the act of the prayer itself. Not because you're a good human being or because you are. It's salah, the fact you have established salah, the result will be تَنْهَى عَنِ الْفَحْشَاءِ وَالْمُنْكَرِ. It will prevent you, prevent me, prevent the person who established salah عَنِ الْفَحْشَاءِ وَالْمُنْكَرِ. The illicit actions, actions that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not pleased with, وَالْمُنْكَرِ, everything that is rejected. Now look at us. So I gauge and you gauge, this salah is how much it's really changing me. And I always say this, when I leave the masjid and the person who was in the masjid performing whatever salah and he blocks somebody else's car, right? Then I really have to, if this is me, I really have to look at my salah. It did not prevent me from something Allah doesn't like, let alone it hurt somebody else. So we need to move the salah from an act of habit because we grew up doing it to an act of worship. Worship, and I put it in the balance, and I look at my salah. Did I do it well? No, I didn't. Why not? You know what I'm saying? Like, subhanAllah, may Allah forgive us. When we have guests coming to our homes, right? And we all cook. And I'm not saying this is haram, alhamdulillah. But what do we usually say? Is the food good? Were they entertained? Did I give them their due right? And that's norm, and that's nice. But why not when it comes to the salah? What do we normally say? Alhamdulillah, salat. Right? Alhamdulillah, I've done it. And even we ask our children, did you pray? Nobody look at how did you pray? So we need, again, the more I put it in my mind, the more I glorify it, the more I will change it. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala actually put it as a sign of your iman. The belief, not how good believer you are. It's a sign of belief. And Allah said it in Surah At-Tawbah. SubhanAllah, when scholars look at the Quran and extract from it principles. And Allah said it in Surah At-Tawbah. Actually, He said it twice. فَإِن تَابُوا وَأَقَامُوا الصَّلَاةَ وَآتَوِ الزَّكَاةَ. He's talking about the disbelievers. And He's saying, if those disbelievers tabu, repented, وَأَقَامُوا الصَّلَاةَ فَخَلُّوا سَبِيلَهُمْ. Stay away from them. Let them loose. So the thing that will move me from kufr, from state of rejecting, to a state of iman is a salah. And there is a strong opinion. You know, I have to say it. Strong opinion. And it's not, alhamdulillah, it's not everyone, but everyone agree on the following. If the person who doesn't perform salah deny that it is a pillar of Islam, that person is not a Muslim. That's why when you ask people, why don't you pray, try not to listen, try not to hear this. Try not, actually try to make them not say it. Don't say it's not an obligation. Then we're in a big problem. Say I'm lazy. Say may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide me. I know I have to do it, but I'm too busy. Whatever these, it's not an excuse, but at least you're still a Muslim. So Allah put it together. And Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam, in hadith, probably almost every Muslim know the meaning. Islam has been built on five pillars. And what is these five? Bunya al-Islamu ala khams. Islam has been built on five. First one is you declare that there is only one God. And the second, salah. Wa iqami salah. And then zakah. You pay the zakah. And then Hajj, Ramadan, and you go for Hajj if you can, and then you fast Ramadan. So the first thing after a Muslim, the first thing you teach someone who accepts Islam is what? After they declare the Shahada. The first thing you teach them? Salah. And then people say, but they don't know anything from the Quran. What do you say? Let them say, Subhanallah. Till Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala teach them Al-Fatiha. So this is the sign, and we look and say, well, she wears hijab, she's carrying the sign that she's a Muslim. True, externally. But my identity, look at it this way, like these days, when you say, give me your ID, right? And it depends, or give me your passport if you're traveling. As a Muslim, my ID that definitely identify I'm a Muslim is a salah. And this is what the Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam sent Sayyidina Mu'adh to Yemen, right? And he said, Qalilah, and he said to him, you are going to a group of people, Ahl Kitab, people of the book. So they are not rejecting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. People of the book. The first thing you're going to ask them to do is tell them to worship Allah. If they know Allah, then tell them Allah made salah obligation on them. So the first thing is you know Allah.
Can I ask a question in between?
Yes, it's okay.
You know, Quran has all the time, everywhere, kind of salah. But Prophet Moses or Jesus in their books, they were also...
I'm coming to this. The only religion that has the act of prayer the way we do it is in Islam. Only. And we're going to come to this, is linguistically we said the meanings, but in Sharia, in the deen itself, in the religion itself, what is salah? It's an actions and it's a sayings, starts by what? Pronouncing that Allah, or glorifying Allah, Allahu Akbar, and ends by salutation. Assalamu alaikum. That's salah. So in Islam, that's the meaning of the salah. In the others, the other meanings. The other meanings. You know what I'm... Did you get the point? So the salah itself, the word has more than one meaning. The action in Islam is the way we will define it, and we will gonna discuss it. But I'm not gonna go a lot in the fiqh, because the problem is not how I do it. The problem is why I am doing it, and actually the bigger question is why I am not doing it. Subhanallah, la ilaha, right? And when you ask people, why don't you pray? Most of the people, what do they say? Actually, no answer. And I have no time. But I have time for everything else. I have time for everything else. SubhanAllah. So he told him, you're going to a group of people of the book, meaning they know Allah. Then tell them to worship Allah and to perform salah. Now, when was salah became obligation, not the five, in general, the act of worship? One of the first things when the Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam was in Mecca, and when he used to pray, and you all know this, when he was praying in front of the Kaaba, what did they do to him? They throw the garbage on him, right? So the act of the salah was one of the earliest thing in Islam. The five salah, the five with the timings where? Alhamdulillah, you all know it's an al-mi'raj. It's the only act of worship in this whole deen, in this whole religion, that became obligation in the heavens. Subhanallah. Yani, why not Hajj? Why not Siyam? What does that tell you? What does that tell me? The important, not for me only. What does it mean to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He made it obligation in the heavens and directly to Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam? And you know the famous hadith, right? Where Rasul alayhi salatu, they call it, it's a long hadith about the hadith al-Isra, they call it. But part of it, when Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam came down talking to Sayyidina Musa, and he said, Salah became an obligation, and Allah asked me to do how many? In the beginning. I leave it for you. I leave it for you. And then five times, up and down, up and down. The last thing was the five. What did Sayyidina Musa say? Go back and tell, ask for less. They will not do it. La ilaha illallah. And look at how Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam responded. What did he say? I'm just too shy to ask for less. Meaning, it's only five. It's only five. That's the meaning of it, right? Like somebody, Allah is exalted, but always to bring examples for us to think. Like when you are buying something, right? And then you bargain, and you bargain, and you bargain. And then they say $1. Right? If you're going to say, I'm going to bargain again, the person next to you will say, come on, it's only $1. Yani, who cannot not pay $1? Right? Subhanallah. So it's only five. Only five. Subhanallah. So five. And then Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam, the last thing he said was what? And I'm going to share this hadith with you because it's a beautiful hadith. And this hadith narrated by Sayyida Aisha. Right? And this is the last, almost the last days of Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam. And he said, when the sickness became heavy on Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam, he used to lose conscious. And then he wakes up. What is the first question? Asalla an-nas? Did people pray? And then she said, no. And he said, go and get me some water. And they dropped water on him. And then he makes wudu, and then he loses conscious again. Then he wakes up. What was the question? Asalla an-nas? Did people pray? And then lose conscious again. Then he wakes up. Asalla an-nas? Did people pray? And then, no, three times. Three times. Imagine you and me. Three times. First thing comes out of his mouth, alayhi salatu wasalam, who taught us everything about this deen. What does that teach you and me? That this is the most important thing. Asalla an-nas? So she said three, and then she said, the last time, she said, no, they are waiting for you. And they are waiting for you in the masjid to pray the Isha. And then Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam asked Sayyidina Abu Bakr to become the imam. Next day, because he was sick for about 3 days before he, alayhi salatu wasalam, passed away. So next day, it was Salat al-Dhuhr. And same thing. And then he woke up and he was feeling a little bit stronger. So two men guided him to the masjid. One of them was Al-Abbas. And then he looked and saw Sayyidina Abu Bakr leading the people. And he smiled. And then he joined. And Sayyidina Abu Bakr saw him. I mean, if you see the masjid, you know, it's very small. And then he saw him and he, the meaning of it is stay where you are. And he prayed behind him. Very sick. He passed away next day. So look at the last thing he was saying. The last action he was saying is this. Then the last thing he said before he died. And there's a three hadith described that as he was dying, meaning, you know, when the froth starts coming out, he said two things. As-salah wa ma malakat imanukum. Salah, the prayer, the act of prayer, and what you have taken as slaves. And one of these hadith says, even when he couldn't say anything anymore, and only you see his chest is moving, his lips were saying a salah. So don't take it lightly. I need to bring these back to me, to bring salah as my identity with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wearing hijab is my identity with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but also with everybody. Salah is my identity with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I am saying to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I am really a Muslim by action. As-salah. Look at Sayyidina Umar. How did he die? What was he doing? Right? So he actually, this is how you it's described. And he said, he was walking, and then he says, Allahu Akbar, right? Get the rows together. And then as he said Allahu Akbar in the middle of the salah, then he came and he stabbed him. And then he lost conscious, right? So they carried him to his home. Again, it was all small places. A sahabi, one of the companions, entered and they said, how is Umar? How is Sayyidina Umar? And they said, he's sleeping. They said, there's one way you wake him up. Just say, it's time for salah. And they said, it's time for salah. He woke up. Allah, it's time for salah. And he prayed, and then he lost conscious. And for us, فَخَلَفَ مِنْ بَعْدِهِمْ خَلْفٌ أَضَاعُوا الصَّلَاةِ. Generations came after them, they let the salah loose. It's not important. If this is something important, do you lose something important? You keep looking for it. You lock it. Make sure you do it. فَخَلَفَ مِنْ بَعْدِهِمْ خَلْفٌ أَضَاعُوا الصَّلَاةِ. Let it loose. They lost it, actually. If you're not translate literally, they lost it. Subhanallah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described it as iman, as I said before. It's the iman is as-salah. Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam in another hadith. I mean, this is beautiful. May Allah reward all these. There's a huge book, actually. It's like 200 pages. It's only about the meanings of salah. The meaning of the salah. And salah in the Quran and salah in a sunnah. And Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam said the following in this hadith in Bukhari. Amurukum bi arba'. I order you four. Wa anhaakum an arba'. And I am ordering you not to do four. So I want you to do four and don't do four. The four that I want you to do. Number one, believe in Allah. Alhamdulillah. Believe in Allah. And he said, do you know what is believe in Allah? It's a simple question. He's talking to Sahaba. What is believe in Allah? He said, number one, you declare there's only Allah. And number two, perform salah. وَإِتَاءِ الزَّكَاءِ وَتُعْطُونَ مِنَ الْمَغْنَمِ الْخُمْسِ الزَّكَاءِ. So, iman. I believe, that means I am a person who believe in Allah and I perform salah. And one of the ways you look at salah, it's the leader of every other act of worship. The leader of every other act of worship. Every act of worship in the Quran was preceded by salah. And we're going to cover this more, inshallah, next week when we talk about salah in the Quran. So it's like I want to give an example so it comes to your mind. It's like, subhanAllah, an example is not coming, but when something define everything else, something define everything else, that you always mention it before you mention anything else, it's salah for every other act of worship. Meaning, this teaches me many things. One of the things it teaches me, priorities. I cannot change the priorities. Allah put it in that priority, then this is how it should be. And if it is not in my life, I'm going to work on it. I am going to work on it. And then, I wasn't with you in Ramadan, but I have a feeling this masjid was full. Full, right? People, again, this is my place or my place, right? How many people in Isha now? Last night? Five? Six? I'm talking about women. Alhamdulillah, men. Alhamdulillah, there was a good number, but still not like Ramadan. Why? Because we made it in a way that Taraweeh in Ramadan, and this is we made it. Allah didn't say that, right? And coming to the masjid in Ramadan is more important than coming for Fajr Salah or coming for Isha in other days. In Ramadan, it was still 10 o'clock, right? It was not 9 or 8. It was actually even more, right? But in Ramadan, we all came, true or false. So what happened after Ramadan? The Salah changed after Ramadan? So bring it back. And Salah, one of the reasons it comes before every other ibadah, because it includes all. What is the act of worship inside Salah? Talk with me. The acts of worship. The common thing I do in Salah is what? I read Quran, right? And then I say, for example, Subhana Rabbi al-Azim. So what is that? Act of dhikr, tasbih. I am glorifying Allah and I am remembering Allah. That's an act of worship. Reading Quran, that's an act of worship, right? Making dua itself at the end of the salah or in your sujood, that's an act of worship. So salah includes all, everything inside. And the best act of worship I and you do is read Quran inside salah. Read Quran inside salah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered it. And this is one of the, excuse me, in Surah Al-Bayna, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala defined what He wants from us in this deen. وَمَا أُمِرُوا, they have not been ordered but to do the following. وَمَا أُمِرُوا إِلَّا, they are not being ordered to do but the following. Number one, يَعْبُدُ اللَّهَ مُخْلَصِينَ لَهُ الدِّينِ, you worship Allah. Huh? There's one word has to come with it. Alone. Alone. This is the meaning here. مَا أُمِرُوا إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُوا اللَّهَ مُخْلِصِينَ لَهُ الدِّينِ, sincerely only to Allah, وَيُقِيمُ الصَّلَةِ, and perform salah. So it's an order from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I want you to memorize the next hadith, because that's going to help you بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ, and help me to focus inside salah. And this is actually in Sahih Ibn Khuzaymah. Sahabi says, and Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam says, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered Yahya, the son of Zakaria, 5 words. This is a long hadith, 5 words. He ordered the Bani Israel, the children of Israel, with these 5 words. And then he says, you, people of Islam, amarakum bi salah. He ordered you to perform salah. That's not what the main thing in this hadith. So okay, he ordered bi salah. And he says, فَإِذَا نَصَبْتُمْ مُجُوهَكُمْ, when you stand up and made your face in front of Allah, فَإِذَا نَصَبْتُمْ مُجُوهَكُمْ فَلَا تَلْتَفِتُوا, do not turn around. And there's 2 kinds of turning around here. One is physical. May Allah forgive us. People pick up their phones and sometimes read it, right? Or do this or do that. فَلَا تَلْتَفِتُوا, do not turn. But the inside meaning is, yeah, don't start thinking about this and that. فَلَا تَلْتَفِتُوا. And now he's saying why. فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ يَنْصِبُ وَجْهَهُ لِوَجْهِ عَبْدِهِ, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be in front of that servant as long as that servant's face is in front of Allah. فَإِذَا الْتَفَتَ فَلَا يَصْرِفُ عَنْهُ وَجْهُ حَتَّى يَكُونَ الْعَبْدُ هُوَ يَنْصَرِفُ, Allah will not change, will not move. I mean, exalted, Allah is exalted. Don't think of it as you and I. But Allah will not change unless I change. When I move, when my heart moves, Allah will yansarif, Allah will move. And I need to put a principle, jazakillahu khair. I need to put a principle for all of us. Some of you may feel this more than the younger generation, because I was just saying this just before the halaqa. When we were growing up, was not listening to what my mother say is an option? You like it, you don't like it, it's true, it may be not true, it may be fair, it may be not fair. It's done. True or false, right? Yeah, Absolutely. Up till now, for those of you who are lucky enough to have your parents still, especially mother, done, right? Younger generation is a different story. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us all. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says a principle, and He said it in Surah Al-Ahzab. And I want you to feel it. And He says, وَمَا كَانَ لِمُؤْمِنٍ وَلَا لِمُؤْمِنَةٍ إِذَا قَضَى اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ أَمْرًا أَن يَكُونَ لَهُمُ الْخِيَرَةُ مِنْ أَمْرِهِمْ وَمَنْ يَعْصِ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ فَقَدْ ضَلَّ ضَلَالًا مُبِينًا. This is a principle. Allah said in Surah Al-Ahzab, it's in Ayah 36. He said, the believing man, the believing woman, if I ask you, are you a believer? If you ask me, are you a believer? What are we going to say? Of course I am. Of course I believe. Fine. Alhamdulillah. This is Allah saying now. No believing man or a woman. And here He separated. مَا كَانَ لِمُؤْمِنٍ, not a believer, man. وَلَا لِمُؤْمِنَةٍ, and not a woman. إِذَا قَضَى اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ أَمْرًا. If Allah and His Rasul, Allah be pleased with Him, عليه الصلاة والسلام, if they order something, they have no choice. أَن يَكُونَ لَهُمُ الْخِيَرَةُ مِنْ أَمْرِهِمْ. It is not a choice. And then He said, if you want to make it a choice and you want to deny, you're going to go astray. So Salah for me is the obligations Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it for you and for me. And you choose to do the other, then we're going to go astray. And actually, and I'm going to bring something practical. Most of us should, but inshallah all of us do. When you get upset, what do you do? طيب, don't answer me. Assume, exactly. Some saying I call my friends, some say take a deep breath. But assume and try it, right? When you get really upset, regardless of the reason, right? Just go and do two rakat. Two, anytime. Anytime. And see what's going to happen. Absolutely. So the reason I'm saying this is because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that's another principle in the Quran. And if we just Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala teach us this, nothing in the Quran, and definitely nothing in the Sunnah, that Allah says do, but, and I want you to put million lines under it, it's good for me. It's good for me. And the other way around, when He said don't, it's not good for me. Just believe in this. SubhanAllah, now you all hear about fasting, right? And how fasting, you know, the diet, 2 to 5, intermittent fasting, or 16 hours of fasting, how healthy it is, what stimulates the immunity, all this. La ilaha illahu. La ilaha illahu. So everything, wallah ladhi illahu, if I put these, just put these principles and train myself, it's good for you. It's so hard to wake up at 4:07. I'm not going to say it's easy, right? 4:07 or 4:03 this morning, I don't remember, right? But if I keep training myself, it is good for me. Good for me. Wallah ladhi la ilahu. Allah will show you the good. He will show you the good. That's why I brought you the example of when you feel upset or when you feel there's so many things going on in your life. I can't focus. I'm shattered, right? Just do two rukat. Two rukat and see. And look at this saying to Al-Hasan al-Basri. You know who's Al-Hasan al-Basri? Like the Imam al-Tabi'in, they call him. Is the leader of the followers of the companions. And he says, Yabna Adam, son of Adam, you and me. Ayyu shay'un ya'izzu alayka min deenik. What is more valuable for you in this deen if you lost your salah? What else is valuable if you lost your salah? Nothing. And again, that's why I'm bringing the salah in Ramadan. Alhamdulillah, we still look at Ramadan as different. Still look at Ramadan as different. But this is alhamdulillah in a way. But in another way, I need to bring salah back above. Above. Meaning my taraweeh or my fajr. Absolutely. It's my fajr. My tarawih in the masjid or my fajr in the masjid? SubhanAllah. So why do I come at 11 o'clock to the masjid on a Tuesday and I'm working tomorrow because it's Ramadan? Then why don't I come for fajr? What else, if you lose your salah, what else is valuable in this deen other than the salah itself? Now, not only human beings do the act of salah, true or false. Who else does it? Right. For example, the birds, when you see the birds, right? Yeah. And the birds specifically, because subhanAllah, you know the ayah. Specifically, Allah made it separate that they glorify Allah, but they also do act of salah. And it's Surah An-Nur. Allah says, أَلَمْ تَرَى أَنَّ اللَّهَ يُسَبِّحُ لَهُ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ. Don't you see that Allah glorify him, or Allah is glorified by everything in the heavens and the earth. وَالطَّيْر, birds. Now, pay attention because there's a lot of birds, alhamdulillah, where we live. And Allah then described them. وَالطَّيْرُ صَافَّات. The birds, what's صَافَّات, is their wings move. Moves. And then here comes. كُلٌ قَدْ عَلِمَ صَلَاتَهُ وَتَسْبِيحَهُ. Allah knows every single bird. La ilaha illa hu. Every single bird, when they move, their act of salah and their act of tasbih, glorifying Allah. So birds perform salah. Who else performs salah other than human beings? These glorify Allah. But act of salah. This is all from the Quran. We just came out of Ramadan. Angels. Angels. What did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says at the end of Al-A'raf? فَإِنِ اسْتَكْبَرُوا فَالَّذِينَ عِنْدَ رَبِّكَ. If they rejected us, human beings, if they reject, if they became arrogant, they don't want to do it. I don't need it. I'm too tired. I'm too busy. Allah doesn't need my salah. All this you hear, right? What did Allah says? فَالَّذِينَ عِنْدَ رَبِّكَ. Those who is with your Lord. Who are these? Angels. يسبحون له. They perform salah and they glorify Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Who else? One more. Jinn. 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 Listen to the Quran and jinn perform salah. So it's not only me, right? So here I am. Everybody around me is doing it. Think of it this way. Since we all came out of Ramadan, right? 1,000 people were in this masjid, more probably. More? I'm sure. Let alone if you were with me in the haram. Millions, right? Everybody is performing salah, whether it's the fard or a taraweeh. Imagine you are, or I am, too lazy and decided I'm not going to do it. What do you look around you and say? Everybody else is doing it. This is what I want you to think. Everyone around us is performing. Birds, jinn, malaika, angels. And I am too busy. I'm too lazy. Allah doesn't need my salah. Allah doesn't need anything from me. You know this famous hadith Qudsi, right? If the first and the end, the last, and the ins and the jinn, everybody was the highest, pious person, nothing from thee. Majesty of Allah and the dominion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will increase. Allah doesn't need it. I need it. What is the first thing I'm going to be asked about? In the grave. As-salah. And then not only now did you do it. فَإِذَا صَلَحَتْ صَلَحَ الْعَمَلُ كُلُّهُ. That's it. If it is right, correct, done, everything else will follow. There's many meanings for this, but one of it is, if you perform salah, sooner or later, it will keep you straight. Sooner or later. That's why when people, complain that these people come to the masjid and do this and do that, their salah will prevent them at one point. You worry about those who do not or does not perform salah. What is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ask Sayyidah Maryam? And Surah Ali Imran, Sayyida Maryam. You always have, when you read about Sayyida Maryam in the Quran, you have to feel different because she's a woman. So we feel it closer. And what did Allah, what did the Malaika said to it in Surah Ali Imran? It قالت الملائكة يا مريم. The angels says, يا مريم, إن الله اصطفاك. Allah chose you. Don't you want to be chosen by Allah? يا ربي آمين. إن الله اصطفاك وطهرك. And he purified you. واصطفاك على نساء العالمين. And he chose you above all the women. All the women, يا ربي, العالمين, everywhere. Who was she? عليه السلام. Right? يا مريم. And then, he glorified, he chose you and he purified you and chose you twice. Stafaki. Chose you, purified you, and chose you over everyone else. Now what the order comes in. Every tashrif, this is how they teach you. Every time Allah puts you in a state of elevation, glorifying, then there is an order is going to come with it. Always. Then comes the order. Ya Maryam, uqnuti li rabbiki, wasjudi, warkai ma'a raki'in. Ya Maryam, so imagine you and me. Ya Maryam, qunuti li rabbiki, submit with awe, submit li rabbiki, not to anybody else, li rabbiki, to your Lord. Warka'i ma'a raki'in. Wasjudi, and here, and again, inshallah, next week we'll cover this, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, sometimes he doesn't use the word salah, but he used the acts of salah. Wasjudi, prostrate. Warka'i ma'a raki'in. And even ruku' sometimes it meant salah and it meant sujood. Warka'i ma'a raka'i. Sayyidina Isa, when he described himself, what did he say? Again in Surah Maryam. وَجَعَلَنِي مُبَارَكًا إِنَمَا كُنْتُ. He's introducing himself. Look at you and me and us when we introduce ourselves. What do we say? It depends how you want to introduce yourself. Right? You put the title, the name of my father, or if the name of my husband, it depends where the highest status, which part will give you the highest status, right? Look what he said, Sayyidina Isa. وَجَعَلَنِي مُبَارَكًا إِنَمَا كُنْتِ. He's introducing himself to his people. Read Surah Maryam. جَعَلَنِي مُبَارَكًا. He made me mubarak, blessed, wherever I am. And this is one of the things I always ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for you also. That you may, he makes you blessed wherever you are. Meaning, wherever you are, goodness is coming. What is barakah? Goodness. Something good comes. Wherever you are, smile. SubhanAllah, I met a non-Muslim this morning, right? And we had like a discussion. And she met like four or five other non-Muslims. And she says, now when I walk in the street, when I see people like you, she was telling me, right? I absolutely think differently. Not because of me, she said, because I met four or five people. Everyone is like, as if they, she was saying, like as if you are guys chain. Everybody was saying the same. That's barakah. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, barakah. Don't think of barakah, blessing is only money or something tangible. That's barakah. Wherever you are, someone will be happy. So happy the way pleases Allah. Somebody will learn something. Somebody who's in a difficulty will become easy. And so he said, وَجَعَلَنِي مُبَارَكًا إِنَمَا كُنْ وَأَوْصَانِي بِالصَّلَاةِ. And he ordered me to perform salah وَالزَّكَى مَا دُمْتُ حَيَّا. Look at this. As long as I am alive. As long as I and you are alive, the salah is. Even if we are paralyzed, we are in the bed, we cannot move. As long as my eyes move, I can perform salah. I should perform salah. And look at you and me now. Nothing. Bathrooms around us everywhere, right? Sajjada, you say, how many sajjadas we have? How many prayer rug we have in the house? And now every design with thickness, right? Everywhere, right? Do you know where is the Qibla? Which app you use? I don't know the time. Which adhan? SubhanAllah. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله.
أشهد أن محمدا
أشهد أن محمد رسول الله. حول ولا قوة إلا بالله. لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله. لا حول